Away now from President Trump's return to the United Nations. Under the Trump administration, the muscle shown by Ambassador Nikki Haley at the world body is a posture that we have not seen in decades, leveling Russia, Syria, and Iran's long untested policies.
Russian corruption is like a virus. It is impeding our ability to achieve complete denuclearization in North Korea.
For too long, the Human Rights Council has been a protector of human rights abusers and a cesspool of political bias.
If the Syrian regime uses this poisonous gas again, the United States is locked and loaded.
And the numbers show that the public approves. In fact, no one in the Trump administration has higher favorability numbers than Nikki Haley in this April poll. In fact, Democrats even like her as much as they like Nancy Pelosi, according to these numbers. So perhaps it's no big surprise that she has also become a target. Here now exclusively, Ambassador Nikki Haley. Ambassador, thank you so much for coming back to the story. It's good to see you tonight.
It's great to be back.
So let's dispense with this question, story that came up. The New York Times, a lot of egg on their face. They said that you had authorized the purchase of $50,000 drapes, and then they had to post a big retraction. What do you say to them about that?
You know, unfortunately, if you're in public service, this is the life we live every day. It's just a matter of this one got through. You know, we're stopping stories every day that aren't truthful or aren't don't have the facts. And so this one, I hadn't even taken the job when these curtains were picked out. And so the idea that this came out, we told the reporters that these were the facts. They knew the facts and they released the story anyway. And I think it goes to show.
So you talked to the New York Times and said this isn't the case and they printed it anyway?
They printed it anyway and it was down in the story in like the seventh paragraph down at the bottom.
And then they had to post a retraction. So that's twice.
Yes, but we shouldn't, you know, all last weekend, every day, wherever I went, people were asking me about my curtains. Yes. The damage is done once the story's out. I appreciate the retraction, but that story follows you everywhere you go. But that's the tough part about public life now.
Yeah, indeed it is. And I also want to ask you about the Brett Kavanaugh situation because everybody's talking about it. What are your thoughts on all of this, on this process?
It turns my stomach. It really turns my stomach. I mean, Ms. Ford needs to be heard, but Brett Kavanaugh needs to be heard. And the Senate has a responsibility here. They have to lead. They have to make sure it's fair. They have to make sure it's responsible, and they have got to take the politics out of this situation.
Would you urge them to go ahead with the vote this week on Wednesday as they plan?
I don't think it's good for either of the individuals to have this dragged out. They need to have a timeline, they need to stick to it, and they need to go forward. But as long as they're fair and responsible, I think that, you know, you should hear from both sides. But the politics is what I think people are so disgusted with.
All right. This is a quote from Business Insider. U.S. relations with the world body have deteriorated thanks to hardline positions on Iran, the Human Rights Council, and Palestine. The administration's unilateralism is wearing thin as member states tire of America's browbeating and unwillingness to compromise. What do you say to that?
I mean, they're tired because we're telling the truth. They're tired because we're being strong again. They're tired because we're not going to have these multilateral organizations mandate the U.S. have to do what they want us to do. We're going to do what's in the best interest of the American people. And I think that's what the president did when he got us out of the Paris climate deal. That's what he did when he said Iran is a problem and being in this deal is not making anyone in the world safer. It's what we did when the president finally moved the embassy to Jerusalem, when that was such an issue. It's what he did when we drew a red line on Syria and stuck to it and actually told Assad chemical weapons aren't going to be used. So, no, I don't expect all countries to love how we are, but that's because we're taking our country back and the message of our country back, and we're not apologizing for it.
So last year, the president said this about the North Korean leader. He called him Rocket Man. We played it on the way into this. Who do you think is going to be the target next week?
I think what you're going to hear from the president next week is you're going to hear him talk about the foreign policy success stories that the U.S. has had over the past year. You're going to hear him talking about building those relationships with countries that share our values. And you're going to hear him talk about American generosity and how American generosity had no lines before. Now the U.S. is starting to look at the aid that is given and say, you know what, we're going to help our friends out. We're going to help out the countries that have the same values. But the days of giving money to any country just because, and the days of giving money to countries that stop America, hate America, or say negative things, it's over. And I think the president's going to explain
that's going to land like a thud with some countries, I would imagine. John Kerry and others in the Obama administration continue to speak out. He had 4 meetings with Rouhani and Iranian leadership and indicated to them, which he admitted, that, you know, they should just wait out the Trump team. And he said it's perfectly normal for former secretaries of state to still be out there having these discussions. He said Kissinger did it, too.
It was irresponsible and it was disrespectful. And you can't put Dr. Kissinger in the same vein as what John Kerry did. Dr. Kissinger, even when he goes and speaks with any country leader, he lets us know before and he lets us know after. He is always briefing us if he ever
has anything. And John Kerry didn't indicate to anyone that he was about to go have conversations. And
no. So Dr. Kissinger is the responsible way to do it. What we saw with John Kerry was not only disrespectful, but it was hurtful to America. When we're trying to make inroads with Iran, where we're trying to get them to identify the fact that they're doing ballistic missile testing, that they're supporting terrorism, that they're moving arms to the Houthis in Yemen. We're in the middle of that. For John Kerry to go and say, oh, wait it out, that hurts America and it hurts the region.
So what's the administration going to do to him? I mean, do you think there should be some action taken? I mean, we talk about the Hatch Act, we talk about the Logan. I mean, do you think that there should be some repercussions for him?
I think the answer is with the lawyers on that. But I think to John Kerry himself, if someone would have done this to him when he was Secretary of State, I don't think he would have sat back and said, oh, they have the right to do that.
So you don't think there's any action will be taken?
I mean, the lawyers would have to see that. But of course, people do go talk to foreign leaders after they have a job. They just usually are respectful about it.
I think a lot of people are going to be curious to hear what the president's stance and his posture is like when it comes to Iran. I mean, we've seen the sanctions. We've seen the impact on their oil markets. We know that General Mattis, for a long time in the Obama administration, talked about a two-pronged theory of a military, perhaps, action or the threat of military action combined with trying to have an impact on the people in Iran to empower them against their own regime. What do you think we're going to hear?
The president is very strong in his beliefs when it comes to Iran. And this has been one of the consistent strong points he has made from the very beginning, which is why he wanted to get us out of the Iran deal, because every country was giving Iran a pass on all of the bad things they were doing in the name of this deal. When the deal wasn't keeping them to be a clean actor in the international community, the deal was giving them a pass. So he got out of the deal. He then said, we aren't finished. There's more to discuss. Iran is going around to the Europeans trying to get whatever business they can. They're losing it left and right. It's time for us to have a real discussion. And that's what you'll see the president do when he chairs the Security Council on Wednesday. It'll be the most watched Security Council meeting ever, I'm sure. But he will be with all of these heads of countries. And he's not just going to talk about Iran. He's going to talk about, you know, the chemical weapons issue that we had to work on this month alone to keep from happening in Idlib and Syria. He's going to talk about North Korea and what we're dealing with there. The fact that we had to take on the Russian incident in the UK with the Skripals. So you're going to hear him talk about these, but with Iran, he does not think we should turn away. He does not think we should let our focus go away. He thinks they're dangerous. He thinks they're issues, and he thinks that the international community has to take that into account.
I got to let you go, but one last question. When the president came back from Singapore, he said North Korea is no longer a nuclear threat. Was that a mistake?
No, I don't think it was a mistake, because I think that what you saw were two leaders that both showed they had the political will to go forward. Now, what does that mean? What it means is we both have to figure out how each defines denuclearization. We made it very clear that we want to see denuclearization with verification, that we can look at that. And I think if you look at what's happened, it's been successful in that we haven't had any ballistic missile tests. Mm-hmm. You're seeing Kim now socialize with the region that needed to happen. You're seeing the fact that even if he's talking with Moon, all of these things, you know, if you take into those 3 sanctions packages into account, Kim felt suffocated. Mm-hmm. And the president, when he felt suffocated, the president opened that door to him to say, there's a different life for North Koreans if you want it. And I think what you're seeing is this is going to happen. It is baby steps. It's not going to happen overnight. We knew that. But we can't accept half measures. That would be doing it like previous administrations. Right. We have to do this completely, fully, and we have to do it by making sure we're continuing the sanctions and continuing to hold North Korea's hand to the fire.
We'll be watching along with the rest of the world. Thank you, Ambassador.